So any questions about Project One? It's due today at midnight. Some of you have questions, a lot of you have submitted. I know there's one of you I'm gonna talk to you after class. And anyone not started Project One? Okay, that would be really bad if you didn't. All right, so for today's class, this is sort of the last lecture we're gonna have on concurrency control. But there's a lot of sort of stuff I wanna cover to get through this, and then at the end, we'll finish off with discussing on Project Two. So I'll start off with doing an overview on the compare and swap atomic operation, because this is gonna be useful for not only understanding how we're doing MVCC, but for Project Number Two, you need to do this in your index. Then we'll do an overview of MVCC and then deep dive into the different design decisions that you have to make when you actually implement MVCC in a real system. And this is sort of what the paper that you guys were assigned to read. And then if we have time, we'll talk about two modern MVCC implementations in both Hackathon and Hyper. And this will sort of show how you sort of wrap all these things together in a single system. Okay, so as a real quick show of hands, who here knows what the compare and swap instruction does? Nobody. Atomic addition, does this not ring a bell for anybody? Okay, good, so one of you. All right, so the compare and swap it's not a new idea. It's been around in processors, I think, in the early 70s, but they've really become in vogue now, maybe the last 15, 20 years, because everyone's trying to build these sort of latch-free or lock-free data structures. And the underlying primitive you're gonna use to make this work is using compare and swap. So compare and swap is a special instruction that the CPU provides that allows you to examine the contents of a memory location and check to see whether its current value is equivalent to some value you're checking it for. And if so, then you're allowed to go ahead and then modify it with a new value. And if not, then it fails. Right? So if say we have a memory location M, we want to check to see whether it has a current given value V, and if it does, then we're allowed to install V prime. So the way you actually implement this in code is to use these atomics built in or CPU intrinsics. And this is sort of one example of how you would do this in GCC with libc. And so you can see, again, it's a function call where, again, we're given to some address in memory that's gonna have some current value. And then we're gonna be given the compare value that we wanna check to see whether this current value is equivalent to. And then we'll have the new value that we install. So the key thing to understand about this is that it looks like a function call, but in actuality, the compiler will rewrite the intrinsic to be like the single instruction to perform this operation. Right? And this is why we say it's atomic. So if you had to write this in assembly or C by yourself, you would write, if value equals this, then do that. Right? And that cannot be atomic. You could have a race condition where someone can come in and change the value after you evaluate in your if clause. So this allows you to do this sort of one instruction all at once, right? And so I'm showing how this one here, sync, bool, compare, and swap. Sometimes they have different names. This one returns a bool whether it succeeds or not. There's other ones you can have different types, like 8-bit, 16-bit, 32, 64. I don't think there's one 128. So in this example here, we would check to see, is the current value 20? If yes, then we're allowed to go ahead and change this to be 30, right? And that's all done in a single instruction. If you can come back and try to say, I want to check the compare value to be 25, and then install the value 35, in this case, the compare would fail. It would not update the value, and this one will return false. So there's other compare and swap implementations or instructions or intrinsics that can do different things, like instead of returning a true or false, you can return back what the current value is, and you can use that to figure out whether you succeeded or not, right? So it's really important to understand this, not only for Project Number Two, but also as we talk about how we're actually going to implement MVCC and OCC from last class, because the underlying principle to make it all work without having to set locks is to use compare and swap. Again, we can use this as a building block to do more complicated operations in our database system. So is this sort of clear what this does, right? It's pretty obvious, but the syntax looks a little weird because these double ampersands in front of it, but it's sort of a built-in thing for libc that the compiler provides for you. All right, so now we can discuss multi-version concurrency control. So the basic idea is pretty easy to understand, right? The database system is going to maintain multiple physical versions in internally for a single logical object in the database. And again, we can be vague on what it means to be an object, right? It could be a table, it could be a page, it could be a tuple, it could be a single attribute. In practice, everyone always tr- treats objects as tuples or uses tuples for objects, because that provides the right amount of parallelism with the right amount of overhead. So the basic idea, what happens is that anytime a transaction wants to write to an object or write to a tuple, the database system is going to create a new physical version for that logical object. And so when I mean logical, I mean at the application level, when you do a query, you would only see one tuple, right? But internally, it could store multiple physical copies of that tuple. And that's how it's going to maintain the, you know, figure out how to interleave the operations of concurrent transactions. And then what happens is when a transaction reads an object, like if you do a query, it'll do a lookup, it needs, the database system has to figure out what's the correct version you should look at based on when your transaction started. So we talked about snapshot isolation last class. In MVCC, this actually works quite nicely, right? You want to see the version of the of an object that existed before your transaction started, and that was made by a transaction that had committed before you started. We'll see how in Hackathon we can relax that a little bit to get better parallelism. So again, the sort of confusing thing maybe when you read the 1000 Core paper is that we talk about MVCC as a single protocol, and in that paper, the protocol we're using is sort of derived from this original work done in 1978 from this guy at MIT who did his dissertation on this. So as far as we know, this is the first sort of layout of the explanation or definition of the MVCC protocol. The first implementation came out a few years later in a system called Interbase at a DEC, which no longer exists. But Interbase actually still exists. They open sourced it now, and it's called Firebird. So it's one of the original databases from the early 1980s. I've never actually used it, so I don't know actually how good it is, but they still maintain it, right? Still have people actively working on it. But it's certainly not as famous as like Postgres or MySQL as an open source system. So the key thing, though, that why this is actually relevant to the discussion with this class is, although the protocol is from 1978, pretty much every single database system that came out in the last 10 years, with the exception of HStore and VoltDB, they all use MVCC. So you have this protocol that's 30, 40 years old, but now everyone's actually using it. And so part of what the paper you guys are reading is try to understand, well, what are the aspects of MVCC that make it ideal for modern in-memory systems, right? So like back in the 1970s, the first two database systems that were doing transactions were Oracle, System R, and Ingress. And when they first came out, none of those systems were doing MVCC. Oracle added MVCC maybe later in 1984, 85, but for a long time, most of the database systems that came out were always doing two-phase locking. And actually, the first version of Postgres was doing two-phase locking, although a variant of MVCC. But so sort of we want to understand what's interesting about MVCC that makes it be used in every single database system that's come out in the last 10 years. So the main benefits we're going to get for MVCC are that the writers aren't going to block the readers. So if you have a transaction that's writing to an object, other transactions can read older versions of that object, so without having to acquire a shared lock and get blocked because of the writer. We can also have a nice benefit that if we have a transaction that's pre-declared as read-only, like SQL allows you to do this. SQL allows you to start a transaction and say, I'm read-only, I'm never going to write anything. So when that happens, the database system can ensure that that transaction is given a consistent snapshot of the database. So you can do all the reads that at once without ever blocking from any other writer that could ever occur, right? And then that's sort of a side effect, or that's what you get when you have snapshot isolation. So it's sort of that one you get for free. And the last sort of thing that's kind of interesting, it's interesting from an academic standpoint. I don't know how interesting it is from in the real world, but with multi-version concurrency control, it allows you to easily support what are called time travel queries. So a time travel query is when you can say, I want to run this query on my database as it existed exactly 2 days ago, or 10 days ago, or a year ago. And again, because we have snapshot isolation, you can be guaranteed that you're going to have a consistent snapshot of the database that only sees the things, or you can only see the things that existed at that point in time. So this is not a new idea. When Postgres first came out, this is one of the things they touted that they were going to be able to support. They eventually took it out of Postgres in like 1999, because as we'll see when we talk about garbage collection, if you're maintaining the entire history of every single version of every single object that ever exists, you run out of space pretty quickly. And certainly in memory system, this might be a bad idea. So it's actually come back now. You start to see newer systems tout they can support this. Like there's a new database system called FaunaDB, and you read their definition of MVCC. They claim, oh, we can do time travel queries. Look how great it is. SQL Server will sell you a time travel query package as well. I think Oracle and IBM have something similar. So as far as I know, every time I talk to somebody, nobody actually ever really does this, right? It only shows up in like financial firms, like Wall Street banks and things like that, because they care about meeting their regulatory obligations. So like you, because of Sarbanes-Oxley, you have to maintain the history of your all financial transactions from the last 7 years. So if you get audited and say, what was going on in my database 6 years ago, time travel queries are the ideal thing to use. But beyond that, most people don't actually need something like this, right? And if you do, you create snapshots and shove it off to like Hadoop or Spark or something like that. So this is sort of nice to have, and it's an interesting property of MVCC, but I don't know how useful it is like in the real world. So the thing I hope you got from when you read today's assigned reading is that MVCC is more than just the concurrency control protocol that we discussed on the 1000-core paper. And again, this is a byproduct of the language being kind of vague or reusing terms in concurrency control. Remember I talked about how there's optimistic concurrency control, but then there's a whole bunch of schemes that are considered optimistic, but they're not the same, right? So MVCC is a protocol, but it's also sort of this higher level idea of how to do transaction management with multi-versioning. And what happens is how you design your MVCC implementation was going to affect how the database has to manage transactions, how it's going to store different versions, how it's going to maintain the indexes. So it affects every single part of the database system. And in that, again, the paper you guys were assigned to read was meant to look at the four major issues of when you actually implement modern MVCC in a current system, and to kind of understand what the different trade-offs are for all of them. And as I said, the last 10 years, it's all these different database systems have come out, and they're all saying they do MVCC. But no one really did a thorough evaluation to decide, what's the right implementation of MVCC. So for example, we'll talk about the Hackathon paper. They have a great paper that talks about how they do MVCC. And they compare maybe just one of the two design decisions, but there's all these other things that they never compare. They just say, this is how we did it, and it's done. The Hyper guys basically said the same thing. So when we were designing Peloton, we knew that we wanted to go and use MVCC to support the hybrid workloads that we talked about in this class. But we didn't actually know for all these different design decisions what's the right one to use, because everyone just picked their own and no one actually tried to understand why. So that's what this paper is really about, right? Since we know we were going to implement MVCC, but we didn't know exactly how we were going to implement it, let's implement everything, see what comes out to be the best, and that's what we'll use in our system. So that's sort of the motivation for this paper. And I will say too, this is the paper you guys were assigned to read. Again, part of the reason why it's not public on the website yet is because we don't know what to call it, the title of the paper, because they don't like a current title that you guys saw. But it's already been accepted to VLDB, and it'll come out in the conference later this year. So you guys sort of get a sneak peek view of it. Okay, so first we're going to discuss the concurrency control protocol. And again, this is how we're going to decide how to interleave transactions, and we've covered a lot of this in the last few classes. Then we'll discuss how we're going to maintain different versions in our system, and then do garbage collection, and then manage our pointers and our indexes. So go through each of these one by one. So again, this is the same table that you had in the paper. And again, this is showing you the scope of the different design decisions that you can have, that there's no one system that makes all the same decisions as another one, right? So I would say sort of high rise down, these are the ones that implemented in the last 10 years. Oracle actually originally came out in the 1970s, but it didn't support transactions at all. And it didn't really come out until the 1983, 84, when they finally added MVCC. The original version of Postgres, when you read the early papers from the 80s and 90s, they talk about using two-phase locking. And then when it left Berkeley and became actually an open source project that people were actually using outside of Berkeley, that's when they switched to using timestamp ordering. And then NODB does MVCC with two-phase locking. So again, you can see there's all these different design decisions. Everyone's doing something different. And we were trying to figure out what's actually the best way. So that's sort of, again, the goal of this work. So another thing to be mindful of too as well is in order to do MVCC, in order for the protocol to work correctly, we need to maintain some extra information inside the tuples to figure out what version are we looking at and whether we're allowed to see it or not. So in the header, in every single tuple, you're going to always allocate this header piece, and that's going to be some number of bits that are going to maintain this extra information or metadata about the transaction. And then everything that comes after that is the actual data. And this will get changed up a little bit when we talk about doing column stores, because for a column stores, you're gonna break out all the columns to be separate, you know, contiguous blocks of memory, and you wouldn't want to put the header for every single, you know, every single column. It wouldn't make sense. But for now, let's assume we have a row store because we're dealing with transactions. So at the top, we have some kind of unique transaction identifier. And again, we said this is typically some kind of timestamp, whether it's based on system clock or a logical counter, it doesn't matter. And then we have the begin and end timestamp, and this is going to tell us what the version lifetime is for this transaction. So based on what timestamp you get for your transaction when you start, that'll determine, you know, what range you fall into for looking at each tuple at each version to decide whether you're allowed to see it or not. And then you're going to have a 64-bit pointer to either point to either the next tuple or the previous tuple in your version chain. And again, we'll discuss how that works and what the different trade-offs of that. And then I'll have some additional metadata that we'll store for the different protocols. We'll see this because we'll discuss doing timestamp ordering with MVCC, but as you read in the paper, two-phase locking and OCC have to maintain their own additional metadata here. So the one thing I'll point out is each of these are going to be 64 bits. So I have a 64-bit transaction ID, 64-bit timestamps, and 64-bit pointers. That's actually a lot when you think about it, right? So we have, in this case here, ignoring the additional metadata, we have four fields we need to maintain, right? So that's eight bytes per field. So we have 32 bytes per tuple. So if you have a billion tuples, you have 32 gigabytes of data just for the metadata. That's a lot, right? So we'll see in Hecaton how you can kill one byte, but you can kill one of these fields, so you reduce eight bytes. But in general, you need to maintain all this stuff. So again, MVCC sounds amazing and avoids having to do locks that you would have to do in two-phase locking, but you still have to maintain, you know, you're paying sort of a space cost to do this. There's not really any way you can compress this down. All right, so for current integer protocol, again, I'm not going to go through each of these one by one. These are the same things we looked at in the previous lectures, and we talked in the 1000 core paper and the OCC paper, right? And the only thing that really changes is that now there's maintaining multiple versions, right? So we'll go through how you do multi-version timestamp ordering. But for these other ones, it's more or less the same idea, that instead of overwriting a single, you know, the master version or single version of a tuple, you create a new version of it, a new physical version. And whether you're maintaining a delta chain or append storage or whatever, it doesn't matter. There's always going to be multiple physical versions. And when you kind of think about it, like in the case of OCC, it's kind of straightforward to think about how do you make this multi-versioning, right? You have the private workspace, and then when your transaction validates and commits, rather than just overwriting the original versions, you just plop them into the table, and just sort of make sure you maintain the chain for all of them. Two-phase locking is sort of the same thing, right? You acquire locks for things you want to write, and then you create the new version and update the chain. All right, so let's go through the timestamp ordering one, because this will be relevant for, this is how we do this in Peloton, and this is how they're going to do this in Hecaton, and this is actually how the original MVCC protocol worked. But we're going to make it more modern and deal with, you know, use compare and swap to make this high performance. So the first thing to point out in our tuple is that we're going to have an additional field that corresponds to the read timestamp. So this is going to correspond to the timestamp of the transaction that last successfully read to this object, or to this tuple. And then we're also going to have the transaction ID that corresponds to the transaction ID that currently holds the lock for this tuple that they're modifying. And then we have the begin and end timestamp, again, that corresponds to the range. So under the sort of MVCC or MV2O, the transaction ID is always zero unless some transaction is currently taking a lock for it. And again, you use compare and swap to try to turn this from zero to whatever your transaction ID is. If you fail, then you know someone else acquired the lock before you did. If you succeed, then you hold the lock for it. And then for the begin timestamp, this is just the timestamp of when you started. And then the end timestamp, this would be the timestamp of the transaction that created this. And then the end timestamp is either infinity, meaning it's the latest version, or the timestamp of the last transaction that created the new version that came after this one here. So let's do a really simple example of a transaction with two operations. Someone wants to do a read on A and a write on B. So for this, when the transaction comes to the system, we'll assign it transaction ID 10, right? I think it's off skew because the guy actually came and cleaned up the filter after I complained so many times of a crashing. So it should not crash anymore, but I guess it's a little off here. And I sent him in the email, I sent him all the YouTube links of like me talking and then it going up and me getting disappointed. Because there's like 4 from this year and 3 from last year. But I think it's finally fixed, knock on wood. Okay, so we're transaction ID 10 and we want to read object A. So we're going to say that this transaction is allowed to read A if the no transaction currently holds the lock, and our timestamp falls in within the range of the begin and end timestamp here. So this is 1 to infinity, so obviously 10 fits in there. So we're allowed to read it. And then we'll go ahead and update our read timestamp to be our current timestamp. And again, we can do this in a compare and swap operation to make sure that if someone came at, say, timestamp 11 and read it, that we don't go back and change it to 10. Right, this read timestamp always has to be going forward in time. And compare and swap allows us to do that with a single instruction. So now when we want to do the write, the first thing we have to do is that we have to acquire the lock on the tuple that we want to modify to make sure that nobody else is trying to do it. So I'll also say too, so I'm showing here these sort of version IDs like AX, BX. This is not actually stored in the database system. This is sort of just for illustration purposes. We understand what we're looking at here. So the first thing we need to do, we're going to try to flip the transaction ID to be our timestamp, doing compare and swap. If we get it, then we know that we now hold the write lock for this transaction. Then we can go ahead and can create our new version. And implicitly, when we store this, we'll set it initially with our transaction ID. And because of that, we'll get the, you know, that we technically hold the lock for this as well. But now we'll set the end timestamp to be infinity, to saying this is the latest version. And then the begin timestamp is the timestamp for when we started, or for our transaction. So now we go back and we update the end timestamp for this tuple, which we can do because we hold the lock for it, so that's okay, to now be our timestamp. So this is saying that this tuple is valid from version 1 to 10. So if your timestamp is greater than this, you shouldn't read this version. You should now jump to and read this version. So once this succeeds, then we can release all our locks and our transaction commits and we're done. And now this version is visible to anybody else. Right? It's basically the same thing as the timestamp ordering protocol that we discussed two classes ago. But now I'm showing you how to do compare and swap to do all the operations you need to do to update these fields atomically, and sort of understand how we do this in the context of a multi-versioning system. So any questions about this? Yes? Her question is, do you release the write lock after the transaction commits or when the transaction completes the write? In this example here, you release it after you commit, right? And the idea is, again, in this case here, you don't want anybody to read dirty data, right? So no one should be able to read anything from a transaction that has not committed yet. When we talk about hackathon, they'll allow for speculative reads, and so they'll allow you to do that, but there's an extra check you have to do at the end, right? This is basically, you don't have to maintain any centralized state to do this, because you know what your timestamp is, and therefore, as you read the tuples, you know whether the thing is committed or not, because you can look directly inside the tuple and see whether it's the flag has been flipped, right? If you do this, in order to allow for speculative reads for dirty data, you'd have to go check some kind of centralized data structure to figure out, well, this transaction this tuple is being locked by transaction 10, but I'm going to go ahead and read it, but I need to figure out, is transaction 10 actually going to commit or not? So then you got to check a centralized data structure. So this is a decentralized way of doing timestamp ordering. We'll see how to do the centralized way that can do the thing you're talking about later. Yes?
What if the transaction ID is smaller than read the TS? What will happen?
So your question is, what if the transaction ID is smaller than read TS?
Yeah.
In that case here, assuming that your transaction ID fits within the range and therefore you're allowed to read it, then you don't update it. Because this can't go back in time. It always has to go forward. So you're still allowed to read it, you just don't update this field.
So what if the transaction is a write transaction?
The question is, what if a transaction is a writing transaction that wants to update this tuple?
Yeah, it's not possible.
So, all right, so let's be clear. So you're saying, I have transaction 5, and it read this,
yeah.
And I have transaction 4 that wants to write to this.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that would fail because you would end up trying to write something that occurred that you're writing something in the past that a future transaction did not read, and that would violate serial order. So the writing transaction would fail. In the back, yes?
So we have two transactions. One is TID is 10 and the other is 11.
Yes.
And the one with TID 11 first read a tuple and set the read 10 cent. And then the other transaction read that. It just don't set the read timestamp. And then the TID 11 abort, how would we like?
Okay. So his question is, oh yeah, I see what you're saying. The question is, I have transaction ID 10, transaction ID 11. 11 reads a tuple and updates the read TS. Transaction 10 comes along, wants to read the same thing, it's allowed to do that because it's in the range, but then it doesn't update read TS because 11 is greater than 10. In that case, you don't care. Right, because 11 came before 10, so all you need to know is that there's somebody read in the future this object. So therefore, I can't update it if I'm in the past.
Yeah.
So yes, there is that could cause a false abort, but the trade-off is you don't have to maintain extra metadata in order to handle that one case. Yes.
I'm getting a little confused about the old tuple. So when I write. Transaction creates a new version. So does it still hold the lock for the old tuple?
Right, so your question is, at this point here, my transaction is going to create this, so it wants to update this tuple, okay, a new version. So I have to acquire the write lock for it, okay? So then when I insert this new tuple, because I added it with my transaction ID as here, implicitly, I acquire the lock for it.
But why do you have to hold the lock for the old?
Yeah, now your question is, why do I have to hold the lock for this? Because I'm not showing the pointer stuff here, the version chain. Because then I have to go back now and change my version pointer to now point to my new version. And furthermore, I have to update the end timestamp to say that this version now stops.
But then after that step, like you change the end timestamp, you can release the lock.
Correct. Yeah. So like, you would change the end timestamp when your transaction commits. So when your transaction commits, then you go back and release all the locks. And you have to be careful to do it in the right order because you don't want, I think you go from newest version to oldest version. So you would release this followed by this because you don't want someone to get to this. Recognize that the end timestamp is less than your current timestamp and try to jump to the next version, but you can't read it because it's locked. So you would release this followed by this. Yes?
I have a question. So the reason you need a read timestamp is that you don't want an earlier write and transaction to modify the content that has been read by a later read transaction, right?
Right, so his statement is, the reason why you need the read timestamp is because you don't want someone to try to go back and write a new version with a lower timestamp that should have been read by a transaction with a higher timestamp in the future, but because we're not actually executing in true serial order, we wouldn't see that, correct, because that would violate snapshot isolation. Okay, so awesome questions. Let's keep moving because there's a lot to cover. All right, so the next design system we have to deal with now is the version chain and how we actually store these different versions. So I'm just showing you the simple example. His question was like, I don't understand why you have to hold these locks because we're actually maintaining the pointers to keep track of the version chain. And so the version chain allows the database system at runtime to figure out what's the right version of a tuple that a transaction should be looking at. So the version chain is basically a latch-free single direction linked list that you build from the pointer in the tuple headers. Right? And we'll see when we talk about skip lists and other indexes why it has to be single direction, because you can't do compare and swap. You can't do atomic swaps for multiple address locations. You can only do one. So you can only guarantee that you have a latch-free linked list going in one direction. And this will be an issue for you guys when you do project two, how to go in a different direction. So the indexes are always going to point to the head of the version chain. The head of the version chain could either be the oldest tuple or the newest version or the oldest version, based on what ordering scheme that you use. But we always consider the head to be whatever the primary key index points to. So in the paper, we talk about how The different threads are going to store these different versions of these tuples in what are called sort of local memory regions. And what I mean by this is that each thread is going to allocate some kind of memory pool, and any single time it has to create a new version, it goes, gets a free slot in its local memory pool, and it uses that to insert it. And because each thread maintains its own memory pool, it doesn't have to set a lock to acquire a new location, right? It's not that you have multiple threads trying to all contend to get to a single pool. Each one has its own local memory. This has become more interesting when we talk about doing NUMA-aware allocations, where you can have, you can figure out that this thread is running on this socket, so I'm going to allocate memory that's close to it. This thread's running on another socket, I'm going to allocate close to that. By doing this, you kind of get that for free. And this is essentially the same thing that the partition version of Silo was doing in the last paper. Right? Sort of each thread has their own sort of chunk of the database. So now for the different source schemes you can have, they're going to determine where and what information we have to store for each new version that we create. So the three different choices we're going to have are to append only, time travel storage, and delta storage. So at a high level, when you squint and you start looking at these things, they kind of really look kind of the same. Like at a high level, they're basically the same, but there are different implications or trade-offs for each of these. So we'll go through each one by one, but append only, basically, you're just going to insert a new version of the tuple in the same table where you store all the other tuples. Time travel storage, you have basically another table where you insert older versions or newer versions. And then delta storage is where you only store the sort of the diff of the tuple that got modified or updated. So for append only, again, you only have one space for storage space or heap for a table. And what you're going to do is that all the different physical versions of a logical tuple are they all stored together, and then we're going to have our pointer maintain the chain going from one version to the next for one single logical tuple. So anytime that you want to update a tuple, say in this case here we want to update this object A, then we would go find the latest version that we want, copy it into a new slot, but then only include the modified, only modify the values that we wanted to modify. So XXX, so the key stays the same, but then we updated the value. And then we'll do another compare and swap to now update the version chain of this previous tuple to point to this new tuple here. So in this example here, I'm going from oldest to newest, right? AX is the oldest, and it points to AX plus 1, that's the next, and then the newest one is AX plus 2, right? So this is going from oldest to newest, but as you can imagine, there's different, you go the other direction too. So in oldest and newest, it's kind of really easy to do because all you have to do is when I want to create a new tuple or new version, I append it to some free slot in the table, and then I update the previous oldest tuple version to point to my newest version. The downside of this though is that you have to traverse that chain at runtime to always find the latest version. So if you're doing OLTP heavy workload where you're doing a lot of transactions and they're trying to always look at the latest version of a tuple, every single time you want to do the lookup, you have to traverse that chain and check the visibility with the begin and end timestamp over and over again. All right, so that sounds bad, but then the plus side with this approach is that when you update the tuple, you don't have to update any of the pointers in the indexes, because the indexes are always going to point to the head of the version chain, which in this case is always the oldest. All right, we'll see how you deal this with garbage collection and secondary indexes later on, but this is actually the easiest to implement. It's just slower to actually run at runtime because you have to traverse that chain. Newest to oldest, the flip of that, right? The head of the version chain is always the newest version, so any single time you update a tuple, update a version, you have to take the latest version, have it point to the previous newest version, and then go update all your indexes now to point to that latest version. But now this is super fast for transaction lookups because when you traverse the index and you find the version chain, your chances are you're going to find the first version. The first version you see is the first version you're going to want. So each of these different chain ordings have different trade-offs, and we'll discuss a little bit about that when we look at some of the graphs. With time travel storage, it's basically the same thing as append only, but instead of appending the new version to the main table with everyone else, in this example here, we'll copy the old version that existed in the main table over to the time travel table, have it update whatever pointers it needs to maintain the version chain, and then we'll go ahead and insert the new master version into the main table and update the pointer here. So in this case here, I'm going from newest to oldest, unlike the last one was going oldest to newest. So the newest version of the tuple is always here in the main table, and then the oldest version is always here. And we have to maintain the same kind of chain over there. So let me take a guess why you want to do this, right? And again, at a high level, this looks basically the same, right, as append only. It's just now that instead of storing all one giant table, I have two tables. And can you take a guess why this helps? What how does this be beneficial? Yes?
You avoid index updates.
Her statement is you avoid index updates, but that's a byproduct of going newest to oldest. So I could just make this oldest to newest, right? I always could just have the oldest version here and just maintain the newest versions over here, right? Yes?
Is it for scan?
His statement is it's easy for scan. But again, that's a byproduct, yes and no. It's a byproduct going from newest to oldest. Because I only need to scan the latest version, then I can just scan this table, right? If I'm doing snapshot isolation and I want to go back to an older version, then I got to go over here. And actually, in some ways, it's harder too, because I have to do the scan here. If I don't find what I'm looking for, maybe also do the scan over there.
I think it's easier to do garbage collection.
Bingo, that's it. She says it's easier to do garbage collection. Absolutely. So, if I'm going newest to oldest in this example here, I don't have to scan anything here. I just go look in here and I find all the old versions and I blow them away, right? So it makes garbage collection much easier sort of implement because you have to look at less data. But you still have to do all the things we'll talk about later on to make it go faster. But again, sort of again, the high level, this looks roughly the same as append only, but underneath the covers, it's slightly different. So this is what SAP HANA does this. And if you buy the time travel package from SQL Server, they're not doing MVCC normally, but this is essentially what they do. And I think in SAP HANA, they go from oldest to newest, and in SQL Server, it's newest to oldest. All right, the last one is the Delta storage, and the idea here is that anytime you update a tuple in the main table, right, you always consider this the master version, and for the Delta storage, I'll say too, it only really makes sense to go from newest to oldest. Going from oldest to newest is kind of, I mean, you can do it, but it's kind of like you wouldn't want to. So in this case, we're going to go from newest to oldest. So anytime you update a tuple, you're only going to copy in the Delta storage the diff of the attribute that got modified. So in this case here, my tuple has two attributes, key and value. But I'm only going to update value. So I just copy the old version of value over here. And then when that's done, I can update it here and then point to now the head of the version chain, or I guess the beginning of the Delta storage chain over here. Again, same thing when I want to update it again, I'll only show, you know, I'll only copy in the old value. So now, if I need to go back in time and find an older version of a tuple because that's necessary for the transaction, my transaction's timestamp, I have to traverse the version chain and basically reapply these deltas in reverse order to get back to the version of the tuple that I need, right? So this is sort of like the log structure merge tree, sort of basically the same idea. All right, so we've done the current tuple protocol and we've done the version storage. Now we've got to deal with garbage collection. Question.
What's the advantage of the Delta storage? You have external work that needs to be done in case you need
it. So her question is, what's the advantage of the Delta storage? So one obvious advantage is that if you're not updating every single attribute in the tuple, you're storing less data. Say I have 1,000 columns or 1,000 attributes, and my transaction only updates one. In the Delta storage, I only have to store that one here. In all the other schemes, I have to copy all the other 999 attributes and put it in the new version. So in this case, you can store less information. That's probably the key advantage as well. And again, the statement that you made before about garbage collection being easier, it's actually easier with this too, because you just take this and you can figure out what, depending on how you organize it, you can say, well, I know all the Delta records up until this point in memory are all for transactions that don't exist anymore and no one can see them anymore. So I don't even need to scan and evaluate their timestamps. I just blow them away, right? So you just take this whole thing and just chuck it. And so MySQL does this. So it makes garbage collection a little bit easier. It makes, you store less data, but it's more expensive, as you said, to do, if you need to go back in time to reapply all these updates. So this is what MySQL does, this is what Oracle does, this is what Hyper does. I think they're probably the only three that I know of that do this. And we'll see how Hyper manages this later on. All right, so for garbage collection, next, again, we're creating all these different versions. We have a lot of, you know, we're appending things, we're adding new stuff all the time. And eventually, these versions are not going to be visible by any active transaction. So we need to go back and clean them up, because otherwise we're going to run out of space. So this assumes that you don't want to do time travel queries. So you want to actively clear out all the old versions. So we're going to say that a database system is able to reclaim a physical version from the database if it knows that there's no other active transaction running in the system that could possibly see that version, right? And this is what you get when you're using snapshot isolation. Or if you know a version was created by an aborted transaction, which means no one should ever be able to see it, so we have to go clean that up. So there's two additional design decisions we have to think about when we do a garbage collection. The first is how we're going to actually find the expired versions that we know they're not visible. We want to reclaim them. And the last one is actually how can we safely reclaim memory to know that there's no other thread possibly looking at, you know, this object we're trying to get rid of right now. And that's a little bit different than a logical transaction, right? This is actually like internally, there's some thread that could be doing something with this tuple, and we need to make sure that we don't free it up and then we get a seg fault. So for this, I'm not going to discuss now. We'll discuss this more when we talk about indexes, because this will be really important for project number two. But I think we alluded a little bit about this last class when we talked about silo, and then the paper you guys read today talks a little about this. There's different ways to actually safely allow to reclaim memory in a latch-free system. So we'll cover that more. All right, so for garbage collection, there's two approaches we identified in the paper. The first is to do what we'll call a tuple-level garbage collection. And the idea here is that the database system is not going to maintain any information about what the status is for different tuples or different versions in the database. And so therefore, it's going to have to go scan the tables or scan the tuples themselves and figure out and try to find the versions that it knows it can delete. And the two ways you can do this is do background vacuuming, which is probably the most common approach, and then the other approach is do cooperative cleaning. And I'll go through both of those examples. And then the last one, the other approach is do transaction level garbage collection. And the idea here is that every transaction is going to maintain its own read-or-write set about what versions of tuples that it saw or read or wrote while it was running. And then when they commit, rather than having to scan the entire tables to find these older versions, you just look at this read-write set for these different transactions and say, oh yeah, these are the versions I can go ahead and delete. And again, you can do this with a separate background thread as well. So for tuple-level GC, let's start off with a quick example to do background vacuuming. So there we have two transactions running in separate threads, thread one and thread two. And the first transaction has transaction ID timestamp 12, and the other guy has timestamp 25. So the vacuum thread, and this is like the best icon I could find of a vacuum. To me, it looks like a vacuum. There's other ones that like there's like a maid pushing in. I didn't want to do that. But this is our vacuum thread. And we can have one or more. For now, we're just assuming we have one. And so what it's going to do is it's going to know with the different threads that are running in the system, and it's going to look inside them and say, what's your timestamp or your transaction that's running right now? And it's going to pick the lowest timestamp of all the transactions that it's examined, and that will tell us what's the lowest threshold it needs to look at to decide whether tuples are actually visible or not, and then therefore they can be deleted. So the vacuum thread will literally just do a sequential scan in the table and examine the tuples one by one. And in this case here, it'll look at the begin end timestamp and see that the range that's specified by this version is below the timestamp of the smallest timestamp of all the active transactions. So it knows at this point there's no transaction that could possibly be running that could ever see these versions. Now, they may, depending on what kind of version ordering scheme you're using or chain ordering scheme you're using, you may traverse the chain and see these things, and in that case you would know that they're not visible to you and you just sort of skip them. Right, so that's what I was saying, you have to be careful, make sure you don't reclaim memory that another thread could be looking at even though they're not actually going to be doing anything with it. So in this case here, assuming there's no other threads running at the same time, we can say that these versions are not visible by any actual transaction, so it's safe for us to go ahead and clear this out. And what happens is, remember I said each thread maintains its own memory pool, so the vacuum thread would say, well, I know that this memory belongs to this thread, so I'll go put this memory location back in its free slot pool, so that the next time the transaction needs to create a new version, rather than allocating another another memory location, it just reuses this one over again. So that's background threads, background vacuuming, and this works with any possible storage scheme that we talked about. This is usually what people get upset about when they use MVCC. This is the one thing that sort of is a big catch or gotcha when they actually try to run this. Because you may be running, you're running your database system, and all of a sudden the vacuum thread decides to start running and it slows you down. In Postgres, up until maybe like 10 years ago, you had to run the vacuum manually, which is a big pain. And now they have the auto vacuum, which is a little bit better, but like again, it can just start running whatever sort of wants. And that can slow you down. And it's certainly also, too, you have to be careful about if you have, a high throughput or highly concurrent application with a lot of transactions running, a lot of threads running, and making new versions in the database over and over again, if you just use one thread, it may not be able to keep up. So that means you have to use multiple vacuum threads and make sure that's lock-free or latch-free. But now that means you're taking away threads you could otherwise use to process transactions to now use to do garbage collection. So that slows you down. And so then you wouldn't have to do this in a single versioning system, like when two-phase locking, but you have to do this in a multi-versioning system. So this is assuring you that the multi-versioning stuff doesn't come for free, like you pay a performance penalty to clean things out, because otherwise you run out of memory. All right, so now the other approach is to do cooperative cleaning, and this is the approach that's used in Hackathon. And the basic idea is that as transactions do a lookups in an index and find the version chain, and they scan the version chain to find the version that they're allowed to see that's visible to them, they're doing the check to see as they go along for every single version to say, is this visible or not? And so as it goes along, if it recognizes that I'm looking at a version that cannot possibly ever be seen by any actual transaction running in the system, so let me go ahead and just clean it up right now as I go along. So everyone's sort of helping out. There's no sort of dedicated thread that's doing the garbage collection. It says as you scan the version chain, you prune things out that are no longer visible. All right? So this only works with going from oldest to newest, because obviously if it was going newest to oldest, you would always land in the newest version, and that's visible, so you're good, right? So this works in Hackathon. They go oldest to newest, because again, in order to get to the newest version, you're going to have to go across and see a bunch of expired versions, and you just sort of clean them up. And you use compare and swap operation to set a flag in the version to make sure that nobody tries to clean the same thing you are at the same time. So one downside with cooperative cleaning, or additional downside of cooperative cleaning, is that if you have transactions never traverse a chain ever, like say I for whatever reason I have some tuple that logical tuple that gets a lot of action, gets a lot of updates, and then it never gets any more updates anymore. But under cooperative cleaning, no one's going to ever clean anything up because no one's going to go across that chain anymore. So these are called dusty corners in Hackathon, because you can think of like you have a big house, you have dusty corners because no one ever goes to it. So in order to deal with that problem, you have to still run the vacuum thread occasionally to go do a sequential scan across all the chains and find the things that should be cleaned up. Okay, so transaction level GC, again, I think it's pretty obvious. Again, you maintain the rewrite set per transaction, so you know exactly when it commits and finishes up, what are all the different versions that it touched, and you know what to clear out. All right, so the last one I think is really important is index management. And again, this is one of the things that, to the best of my knowledge, hasn't really been any papers, at least in recent years, that really sort of looked at this problem in the context of MVCC. But it actually is a big deal. So the question we're trying to solve here is, what should the indexes actually point to for our version chains? So if you have, for the primary key indexes, they're always going to point to the version chain head. Regardless of whether it's oldest to newest or newest to oldest, or what storage scheme you're using, you just always need to know that you're at the beginning of the version chain. So how often the database system is going to have to update this index determines how often they're going to have to create new versions, and whether you're using oldest to newest or newest to oldest. If the transaction updates an attribute that is indexed in the primary key, then rather than trying to be smart about making sure that, like, oh, we can just flip that one attribute and make sure all the pointers still work nicely, typically what everyone does is you actually just delete the old primary key for that tuple and insert the new one. Right, that's the easiest way to implement this. The downside is that you lose the version chain because now you're dealing with actually a new logical tuple rather than the same one from before. But this is what pretty much everyone does because it's just so much easier. But secondary indexes are way more complicated. And actually, this shows up actually in the news a lot. Well, I don't say a lot, but like when people discuss the, you know, the trade-offs between MySQL and Postgres, this is like one of the key things that people don't realize that you need to be mindful of when you decide your database system. And actually, this sort of shows up in this, there was an article last year, sort of right at the time we were finishing the paper, on the engineering blog for Uber. So the title of the article is "Why Uber Switched from Postgres to MySQL." And the key, one of the key things that they cite is how you're going to manage secondary indexes. The story is actually more convoluted than that, right? They started with MySQL, and then they hired some guy who was really like Postgres, and they switched to Postgres. And then they realized one of the things that Postgres does poorly for their workload is how they manage secondary indexes. So then they had to switch back to MySQL. So they went from MySQL to Postgres back to MySQL, which I'm sure it cost them millions of dollars. And had my paper been written before then, they could have saved millions of dollars, right? All right, so the two ways we're going to manage secondary indexes is to use either logical pointers or physical pointers. So with a logical pointer, what we're going to do is we're going to use some kind of like immutable identifier, like a logical identifier for the tuple that does not change no matter how many different versions we make, right? And that's what we're going to use as the pointer, the value for the key value pair inside of our secondary indexes. So now we have to then be able to map this logical pointer to the actual physical pointer of where the head of the version chain is. So this requires us to have an extra indirection layer to make this work. So the two ways we can implement this is use the primary key or a tuple ID, and I'll show what that looks like in the next slide. And then the other approach is use physical pointers, and this is where we just point to the head of the version chain. All right, so let's look at the example. So for the primary key index, as I said, anytime we want to do a lookup on this, like here's our chain, we're going append only, newest to oldest, but it doesn't matter what scheme we're using. For our purposes, it's just easier to understand. All right, so if we do, say we do a lookup on the primary index, like get the object A, well, the index will tell us exactly the physical address for the head of the version chain. So voila, we find what we wanted for, we're done. So now, anytime that we, in this scheme here, anytime we update the tuple and create a new version, then we have to go update our primary key index to point to the new version chain. That's not that, it's not free, but it's not that, I don't think it's that bad, especially when in memory system. And the benefit, again, is if most of your transactions only need to look at the latest version, then that's an okay price to pay, right? If you're doing oldest and newest, then you wouldn't have to update it that often, only when you do garbage collection, but then it requires every thread to do a lot of redundant work to doing the version chain traversal. So now for the secondary key index, if we're using the physical pointers, again, the same thing. We're just pointing to the physical address, the physical location of the head of the version chain. So again, that's not that big of a deal if we only have one secondary index. But if we have a lot of them, then they're all going to point to the head of version chain. So that means that any single time you update this tuple, you have to go traverse these indexes and do the update to change the value now for that key. And this is the key reason that, one of the key things that Uber cited about why Postgres was not performing well for their application. Because every single time you update a tuple, regardless of when you update the key or the value for that the index is indexing on, right? The attributes that are using for the index, regardless of whether you update or not, you still have to go update them anyway, because you have to update the pointer location. So the two alternative approaches are to use the logical pointers. Right, and the first one is that you can just store the primary key as the value for the secondary index. But then when you want to go get the physical address, you just now do a lookup on the primary key index, just as before, and that gives you the version chain header, a version chain head. This is fine if your primary key is like less than 64 bits. Right? If it's just an integer, then that's not a big deal to store that, because you're going to store 64 bits for an address anyway. If it's something larger than 64 bits, then this can be problematic, because now you're storing a lot more space to store the value to do this extra indirection lookup. You can be smart about things like, if I know my primary key is a subset of the secondary key, or the secondary key is a subset of the primary key, then you don't have to store all this redundant information. But if the secondary index is the key is very large, then this is actually going to be a waste of space. Another approach is actually use these, again, the logical pointers, or the sort of a tuple ID identifier. And the basic idea is here is that you're going to have some kind of other index. It could be like a latch-free hash table, or it could be another B plus tree, or whatever you want to use. And then, so when you do a lookup in the secondary index, you get a tuple ID, and then this map table will tell you from the tuple ID what's the physical address for the version chain. And the nice thing about this is that no matter how many secondary indexes I have, anytime I update the tuple and I need to update the physical address of where the head of the version chain is, I just update this one index, right? And that causes all the secondary indexes to be able to use that new address without having to go update all of them. So typically what happens is, in your database system, we don't do this yet, but eventually we will. If you don't declare a primary key index, then the database system usually creates one for you internally. Like in MySQL, if you don't declare a primary key on a table, they create an internal record ID for you. And that's essentially what they're using for the tuple ID addresses. It's not something you can see logically from the application, it just makes the bookkeeping internally easier. So eventually we'll add that. I think for now we just store, we do it this way, and we just store some a unique identifier for the tuple. But it's not embedded in the actual tuple itself. Yes?
So which version of the attribute value do you store in the secondary index?
That's a great question. The question is, what version of the attribute value do you store in the index? Excellent question. The indexes are completely agnostic to versioning information. They don't know anything, right? Because what needs to happen is you get the head of the version chain, and it's up to now the worker thread for that transaction traverse and try to figure out what's the right version or not, right? So this is what I was sort of saying before. If you update the primary key index, rather than trying to be smart about like maintaining the same version chain even though the primary key is different, we just insert it as, you know, you just insert it as another whole tuple. So regardless of whether, you know, if you're looking up for an older version, you find that. If you're looking at the newer version of the primary key, you'd find the other version chain. And that's semantically correct. As far as I know, I don't think any database system actually maintains extra versioning information inside the index. It makes it way more complicated. But I might be wrong about that. I think Mastree might be doing something, but I think it's all for all internal state.
Even if you were just updating the, even if you just had primary key indices, wouldn't it still take a non-trivial amount of time to like scan the index to find the tuple every single time you make any?
So his statement is, even if you only had the primary key index, isn't it still going to be expensive to still traverse the index to find, just to find it or update it?
Yeah.
Yes, but like, it's, I mean, it's what, n log n,
yeah.
And it's in memory, so it's not great, but it's not the end of the world, right? The argument comes into play when you want to do oldest and newest versus newest to oldest, and I mean, depends on the application. If you're OLTP heavy, you're write heavy, and you're creating all these new versions over and over again, you always want to find the latest version. So it's better to have one thread pay the penalty to traverse the index to then point to the latest version, rather than all threads have to traverse the version chain over and over again. And depending how aggressive your garbage collection is going to be anyway, you're going to be pruning these versions over and over again with oldest and newest, and so you're going to still have updated anyway. It's a good point, though. I mean, that's sort of the reason why we're trying to figure this out. Like, we want to test all these things. Any other questions? Okay, cool. So I'm going to only show one graph. So although the paper's been accepted, I actually don't know what the right answer is yet, of like what really is the best scheme to use, or best choice of different design decisions that we talked about. So this is just one graph for one workload in one scenario, and I don't want anybody to think that this is applicable to all possible different types of applications. But this is the TBCC workload running with 40 warehouses on a machine with 4 sockets and 10 cores per socket. So you have a total of 40 real cores. And so what you see is that the Oracle, MySQL, essentially the same thing, NuoDB and Hyper actually perform the best. And again, only for this one application. So the only thing that these, so there's not one design decision that all these things have that make them all better. Like the Oracle MySQL used the Delta records, NuoDB, or Hyper uses Delta records, NuoDB uses the append-only storage, Oracle MySQL are using MV2PL, NuoDB is using MV2PL, Hyper is using using the MVOCC. So again, like, it shows that these guys are the best, but there's not anything I can point to, except maybe using logical pointers instead of physical pointers, that makes these guys work better. But in case of TPCC, there's only two secondary indexes, so it's not that big of a huge cost. So this is kind of unsatisfying, right? Because it's always nice to say, like, look, after all this work, here's the one thing you should actually do whenever time you build a database system. But again, it depends on the application, so things are always different. Okay? All right, so we only have a few moments left, but I want to talk a little bit about what Hackathon does. And then maybe we'll save Hyper and HANA for a later time. So Hackathon started as an incubator project at Microsoft in 2008. Where they were set out to build a new OLTP engine for SQL Server. And the project was led by probably one of the two best database researchers and developers in the world, Paul Larson and Mike Zwilling. So Mike Zwilling helped build, he was a Wisconsin Database Group alum. He helped build Shore in the 1990s, and he was one of the first guys they hired to go help complete the port of Sybase to work on Windows NT. And then Paul Larson was he just retired last year, but he was a researcher at MSR and the Database Group. He invented linear hashing. He's invented a lot of awesome things over the couple years. And so what I really like about the Hackathon project is that they had a bunch of design constraints that you don't really see in academia, but they had to deal with because they're actually dealing with a real system as a real product. So the first thing is that they had to make sure that the Hackathon engine integrates with the whole SQL Server ecosystem. So it's not like us here in academia, where we're building our new database system where we just start from scratch and we don't have any customers to worry about. Right? In their world, they just couldn't start building a new database system because no one would ever actually use it, because everyone already has all their tools and scripts and other things that they use for SQL Server. They want to be able to just plop their thing in and work with that nicely. The other thing they had to deal with is that they wanted to make sure that they got better performance, but that the performance gains that they got were predictable across all OLTP workloads. So we saw last class, and we saw in the 1000 Core paper, in the case of the HDR protocol that's used in VoltDB, the single-threaded partitioning approach gets amazing performance for some applications. If your application can be partitioned nicely, such that every transaction only has to touch a single partition, then the HDR protocol outperforms everything. But then as you saw in that one graph in the silo paper, if you have maybe 15% of multi-partition transactions, then the performance actually gets worse. Right? And it actually creates and gets terrible performance at the far right end of the graph. So this would actually be terrible for a product you actually wanted to sell. If you said, hey, look, buy our new database system, for some of you, you're going to get 50x performance improvement, but for some of you others, you're going to get negative performance improvement, right? That would be terrible. So they made design decisions that may not get the sort of optimal best performance you can get at all possible, but across the board you get the best consistent performance gain. So instead of going from 50x, they might go from 5x, and that's still a pretty significant gain. So again, we're low in time, so maybe I'll just skip some of this, how they actually do MVCC. But basically they're doing the same begin and end timestamp visibility check that we talked about before. The only difference is that they're going to have a timestamp for when your transaction starts and a timestamp when the transaction ends. And they can use this to get rid of having to store that extra transaction ID field. So they'll save 64 bits by maintaining maintaining an extra timestamp. Again, I'm sorry that I'm rushing through this, but it's sort of complicated. I don't think I'll do it justice in the short amount of time that we have. I guess the last thing, one graph I'll show is that they did sort of the same kind of evaluation that we did, where we were comparing sort of the OCC approach versus the two-phase locking approach. And for this particular study here, they showed that the optimistic approach actually outperforms the pessimistic one. This difference doesn't seem like a lot, but the scale is in the millions of transactions. So this is doing 1.5 million. This is doing 1.25 or 1.3. So this is like getting an extra 100,000, 200,000 transactions a second by using the optimistic approach instead of using the two-phase locking approach. And again, if you think about what MySQL and Postgres can do in a single box, maybe 30,000, 40,000, 50,000 transactions a second. So getting a $200,000 bump on a single box is pretty significant. So again, I'm just going to skip all this because I want to get to the project number three. So the main takeaway I want you to get from all this is that MVCC is probably currently the best approach we have now to support mixed workloads. The paper you guys read was all about just pure OLTP. We are in the process of doing additional studies to understand how this works in a hybrid system. And so some of the design decisions that we made that were better for OLTP may not be the same for for HTAP. But that's sort of, we don't know. We don't know the correct answer yet. And then for people that think about what to do for Project 3 or other research projects for capstones and things like that, I think there's still a lot of remaining questions we want to solve or answer in the context of doing in-memory MVCC. So things how you do block compaction. So instead of doing garbage collection, just always freeing up a slot and then reusing it again, you may actually want to take two blocks that are sort of half empty and combine them together into a single block. Or reorder things such that all the old tuples are together in a single block and the newer tuples are already put in another block. Version compression or compression in general we're interested in, right? So instead of having, since I said you couldn't always do time travel, maintain time travel information because you would run out of space, there's a way to compress the versions in a smart way so that you can still maintain all the previous history. And then online schema changes or alter tables and things like that is actually how to do this in context of MVCC and still get really good performance is actually, we're looking into that now. Okay, and again, the remaining 10 minutes, I want to talk about Project 2. So the Project 2 is to implement a latch-free skip list inside of Peloton. So there's a quick show of hands. Who here knows what a skip list is? One, two. All right, maybe a small smattering of people. Okay, so skip list is a, it's called a probabilistic data structure. So unlike a B plus tree where you know exactly how to traverse down to the tree going left and right, in a skip list, when you insert new entries, you'll flip a coin and you'll decide whether you stored extra information at the higher levels of the tree. So again, you'll squint at a high level, it'll look like a B plus tree, but the difference is that you have this sort of this probabilistic part at the top. So you're going to be required to implement a latch tree skip list in the system that supports both forward and reverse iteration. And this is important because since we said we're going to do latch free, it means we're going to use compare and swap. And I said earlier, you can only do compare and swap on a single address location. So that means you can only guarantee that you're latch free going in the forward direction, right? So you have to come up with a way to have to do it in a reverse direction. You're never going to get the exact same performance, but you want to do this again without having set locks. And then you're going to have to be able to support both unique and non-unique keys. So both primary key indexes and secondary key indexes, or non-unique indexes. And I'll discuss different ways to actually how you implement both of these approaches, I think next class or next week. So what we're going to provide you guys with is a header file that provides, two header files that provides the index API that you have to implement. So if you implement this API, you can just plop your index in and everything else will just sort of work. Again, same SQL queries and everything will just work without having to change anything. So some of the hard things that we'll already do for you, like how to do data serialization, so how do you take a bunch of attributes and pack them into sort of a compact byte form and store that as the key, and how to do comparisons for these keys. We'll already do all that for you. So you're really just building sort of the scaffolding of the data structure to make this all work. So I'll discuss skip lists next week, but as you see when you start to think about this, there's a lot of different design decisions you have to make that I'm not going to tell you how to do. Like I'm not going to tell you how to do garbage collection. I'm not going to tell you exactly how to do reverse iteration. There's a lot of different examples out there. There's a lot of different papers and stuff like that to talk about how skip lists actually work. As far as I know, only one database system uses it for the primary index, like the main data structure, and that's MemSQL. I'll discuss more about that next week. And so we'll discuss sort of the canonical example of the skip list, but there's more optimized versions that you may want to look at as well, right? Because the skip list by the generic version of the skip list actually gets terrible cache locality and actually gets bad performance. So there's ways to sort of fix that. So again, we're not going to hold your hand through the entire process. Well, we can discuss different trade-offs and different things, but it's up to you to decide how you actually want to implement this. And so everything, we'll provide the same thing as before, we'll provide you with C++ tests to not only test the correctness in a multi-threaded environment, but also check the performance of your system. And we also have a reference implementation of a BW tree that you can look at to compare your skip list against. So the BW tree, I'll talk more about this next week, is another latch-free order-preserving tree-based data structure. And this is the one that actually came from the Hackathon guys. I'll discuss why they picked this over the skip list, because it's actually kind of interesting, and it's relevant to why MemSQL picks skip lists. And again, just like before, we strongly encourage you to do your own testing. So I think what we'll do is rather than just having you submit You know, for the extract example, you could submit as many times as you want, and then we were going to grade you on all the test cases that we ran when you actually submitted it. We'll have additional test cases that we're not going to have under Autolab that will run in addition to the ones that Autolab runs, that we can check the correctness of your data structure as well. So we'll do additional speed tests, and we'll do additional correctness tests that Autolab won't cover. So that means you're going to have to learn how to write your own test cases and make sure that you have good coverage of your data structure. We're also going to go back and look at the documentation in your code and actually be more strict now about how you're actually, what the code actually looks like. And this is going a little bit more deeper than just using Clang format. Right? And then we'll also go back and look at the inspections manually to make sure that, it does, you didn't plop in, you're not referencing the beat of a tree inside of your skip list to make it look like you implemented a skip list without it, right? All right, for grading, we're going to run additional tests beyond what we provide you, but we're going to provide bonus points for anyone, for maybe the top three or top five groups with the fastest implementation. So it is my hypothesis that the beat of a tree that the student built last year will outperform all of your skip lists. And that's not a knock on your coding abilities. It's just we think that BWTree is faster than the skip list, and the Microsoft papers show this. But we're actually curious to see how fast you guys can get compared to our best index. Okay? And again, we're doing the same thing before. We're on Clang format to make sure that your format is correct. And we're going to use Valgrind to make sure that you don't have any memory leaks. Okay? All right, so again, this is a group project. Everyone should contribute equally. I don't like to hear complaints that so-and-so, went on spring break and did not do anything. It happened last year. We don't want it to happen this year. So we want everyone to contribute, equally to the project. And I'll be checking, if there's an issue, I can check commit history and make sure that everyone is doing progress and making the same progress. So if you're not in a group yet, please email me so we can figure out who to group you up with, okay? Who here is not in a group? Oh, that's nice. Okay, that's easy. Awesome, done. All right, so the due date will be March 2nd, so you have a month to do this. For three people in a group, I consider this a reasonable amount of time. Skip list is actually, the basic version of skip list is actually very easy to implement. Like a latch-free skip list you can do with forward iteration, not reverse iteration, with forward iteration, you can maybe implement in 500 lines or less. It's actually really easy. Making it run fast and making reverse iteration and plus doing garbage collection and all the other things to actually make this a real index you can actually use is a little more complicated, and that's why we're giving you a month, okay? And there's a lot of implementations out there that you can look at, but again, the same rules apply. Please don't copy other people's code. You can be inspired by them, but don't just copy and paste. All right, so the instructions for Project 2 and all the header files are not available online yet. I'll take care of that after class. Any questions about Project 2? Okay, awesome. So next class, we'll discuss index locking and latching. And this will be a precursor to the lecture on Tuesday next week when I'll lay out what the skip list actually does. But I encourage you to go, there's probably YouTube videos or blog posts about what skip lists actually do. I think it's good for your own, for preparing for this project to go look at what these things are ahead of time. Okay? Awesome, guys. See you on Thursday.